Welcome all to today's webinar. Just a few housekeeping items before we get started. This webinar is being recorded, and the recording will be emailed to all participants and those who registered but could not join the live presentation. A copy of the slides used during today's presentation can be found in the handout section. There will be an opportunity to ask questions toward the end of the webinar, including questions that were previously submitted during registration. Please submit questions at any time during the presentation, and we will get to as many questions as possible. Now, at this time, I'd like to turn things over to Dr. Sandy Shulman, 2020 President of APA, to get things started. Dr. Shulman?
Thank you very much. Hi, everyone. My name is Dr. Sandy Shulman. I am the 2020 President of the American Psychological Association, and I'm really pleased to welcome you to today's webinar. It's specifically intended for public officials and their staffs, those of you who are out there communicating every day on the front lines of this crisis situation. Our webinar today is entitled Using the Psychological Science of Crisis Leadership and Communications to Navigate the Coronavirus. There are a lot of webinars on leadership if you Google or you look at your email today. And we have some of the same messages, I'm sure, that are on some of those webinars. But I think we have a few things to offer here that are distinct that might be very helpful to you. And that is our goal here, after all, is to make psychology and psychologists helpful to you in this time of crisis. Because we are a science of human behavior, we can apply many, many aspects of human behavior to this particular crisis. And in a very broad way, it's everything from how to be an effective leader in a crisis to how experiencing uncertainty affects human beings' decision-making abilities, to how to address the very real mental health needs that are facing our society right now, and how to face what's going to be facing us going forward when we get to whatever will be the new normal after all of this has been, we've gone through all of this. If you would change the slide, please. So I really want to welcome you. We have three really distinctive psychologists lined up to present today. And I'm going to, and they have three topics that we think are especially relevant to your work. And today you'll be hearing from Dr. Ellen Peters, Dr. Baruch Fischoff, and Dr. Roxanne Cohen-Silver. And I'll tell you more about each one of these incredible experts as I bring them into the conversation. I'm also joined today by Dr. Arthur Evans, who's the CEO of the American Psychological Association. And he's going to be helping moderate the question and answer portion of this event. Let me say briefly that in addition to being the 2020 American Psychology Association president, I'm also a partner in an international leadership development consulting group, and my specialty over the last 25 years is working with leaders who have challenges facing uncertain situations. So it's sort of ironic that I am addressing this situation this year in my own presidency. One thing I can say for certain is that all leaders that I know right now are facing the challenges of leading in uncertain times. So hopefully you know at this point that you are not alone. So let me start off and kind of set up the context for this conversation. If you would change the slide, please. Here are some key issues that I think we're all starting to get used to at this point. It's now being called the invisible enemy, meaning this is something different than many of the things that we've experienced before, like a terrorist attack or a natural disaster, or some of the more finite events in our lives, where there's something more tangible that you can see or fear or blame. Another characteristic of this situation is that even with social distancing public measures in place, we don't know how long this crisis is going to last. From my perspective, we're actually right now dealing with what I call the new abnormal. We haven't even gotten to the new normal yet, which I think will roll out over time. It's going to be a very challenging series of events, I believe. And importantly, even when the spread of this virus itself is contained, I believe our nation and world will continue dealing with the physical, psychological, social, and political implications and consequences. The other part of this is that this situation does have widespread impact in a way that most other situations do not. the situation feels like it's affecting everyone and it feels like it's everywhere. And that becomes critical to recognize that that some people, while it's everywhere, some people are feeling and being impacted in different ways than others. And last but not least here, this really is unprecedented. We don't have a roadmap. We don't have a blueprint for this. We can use what we know. We have science we can apply. And at the same time, we're applying science with great humility. I would also say we are also building the plane as we are flying it. So we're trying to put the best of our existing knowledge together with our ability to learn as we are doing and going through this experience together. And I think that's probably the most effective way we'll get through it. So let's go to the main points at hand today. If we go to the next slide, please. One of the things we want to talk about a little bit today is how you show up as a leader. And what we know from research is that how you show up as a leader greatly affects how others perceive you and subsequently how they will behave. And we're here, we're not talking about what you actually do, just how you show up, who you are as a person. Now, this is not the time for a complete makeover as a person. So we're saying you start with who you are, but people are judging you by characteristics and traits that they see over time that you put together consistently that tell them whether you are a credible, authentic, compassionate person. So they're going to look at who you are, not just what you do as a person, especially since this is going to be an ongoing situation where you are consistently communicating with the public. Today's presenters are going to talk a lot about how you show up as a leader in a time of crisis. And they're going to talk about the underpinning scientifically of things like how you are a steady, calm, and consistent presence, how you generate what I call realistic optimism and stay comfortable with an inevitably heightened level of uncertainty, how you remain authentic and honest through a situation that has many, many changes and bumps in the road. And then there are two other things I think are absolutely critical for how leaders show up. One of them is this is a wonderful time and an important time for you to be mindful of your own shortcomings. So if you've ever gotten feedback as a leader of something you do too much of or too little of, you're going to tend to exaggerate it in a time of crisis and high pressure. So for example, you or one of your colleagues if you've gotten feedback over time that says, gee, you don't tend to listen very well, this would be a good time to be paying a special attention to that because your tendency may be to listen even less in a time of crisis. If you've had the feedback as an official, for example, or a staff member in the past, that you tend to get defensive at public criticism, be very careful now. You might have a heightened sense of that as your own sensitivities and your own feelings are engaged in this process. And then the second thing I would really talk about here is that empathy and conveying empathy and understanding are absolutely critical to the public. Conveying that you get where people are, that you care where people are, that you recognize we're all different, but we're all in this together at the same time. That's probably the most basic message. And you'll hear a lot of that underpinning a lot of the things that our experts will be talking with you about today. If you go to the next slide, that it's obviously important about how you behave in a crisis as well, what you actually do. They're going to talk today a lot about how you communicate and behave in a time of crisis. And they're going to emphasize some of the following kinds of things: putting your values and your priorities up front and conveying the message that this is something bigger than any one of us. Various ways to talk plainly, as Harry Truman would have said, using plain talk. Being able to demonstrate an ability to tolerate reality or bad news while you're in a learning mode and in an uncertain situation. And then a couple of other things that I think are absolutely critical to how you behave in a time like this is that you need to surround yourself with diverse perspectives to promote your own learning. People need to see you being in a learning mode and conveying that you are learning as you're going on, and that you are demonstrating your learning going through this crisis. because everybody knows there are no complete answers. And so your ability to convey that you're a good learner and that you're learning will give them some hope and some confidence. And then keeping those diverse perspectives with you as you go along to make sure that you don't prematurely close on solutions or views of the situation that may not accurately reflect reality. And then the other thing that I think is really important about how leaders behave, and you'll hear this in our experts' conversations today, is to stay focused on the critical few. In other words, keep what's significant significant. There's so many urgent distractions at this point in the middle of things that are urgently important. And you really need at this point in time to make sure that you stay really clear about the few things you want the public to understand as you're communicating with them. So, having said all that, if you go to the next slide, please, what is most important at this point? There are three things today, three topics that we really wanted to help address that we think psychology has a lot to say about in this time of crisis in leadership. One is how you understand perceptions of risks, not just the reality, but perceptions of risk by people, and how accurately you communicate in a time of crisis. Number two, how you as a public official fulfill your duty to inform in a context of uncertainty. And number three, how you as a public official convey and promote healthy coping and resilience of the public. Note the clear role that empathy and communications will weave itself throughout all of these communications. And with the high degree of uncertainty that we have at the moment, remember that you really need to understand your own behaviors first, and then obviously focus on how other people are feeling, how they're perceiving things, how they're behaving, and some of the reasons why. And that will make you more effective in responding continuously through this public crisis. With those things in mind, I'd like to introduce our first speaker. If you could show the next slide, please. Dr. Ellen Peters is the Philip H. Knight Chair and Director of the Center for Science Communication Research at the University of Oregon. She's an expert in decision-making and the science underlying communication. Her primary research interests are how people judge and decide things, and how evidence-based communication can actually boost comprehension and improve decision-making in health, financial, and environmental contexts. Dr. Peters is going to lead off with evidence related to how you as a public official understand perceptions of risk and how you accurately communicate it to others in times of uncertainty. This has a lot to do with empathy, reality, and effective communications. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Peters.
Thank you very much, Dr. Schulman. Good afternoon, everybody. I wanted first to thank APA for arranging this opportunity for us to speak, and also to all of you for being present today. As Dr. Schulman suggested, my talk today will be essentially in two parts. The first part is looking at how do we understand your audiences? How do you understand the public and the reactions that they're having in the coronavirus? So first, how people use their emotions in risky situations. And then the second part, I'll look more towards how to communicate so that people better understand and use information that you believe is critical to them, while hopefully quelling some of the panic. Next slide, please. We have a country that is in a great transition right now. Fear and uncertainty abound, and there's no end in sight. What we know about the psychology of emotion and risk perceptions, though, can help us understand how the public is reacting to the situation. And in particular, people use their emotions in three ways that I'll discuss. Next slide, please. First, people often use their emotions instead of logical analysis to evaluate risks. They use that emotion as a substitute for other information, like the numeric chances of a risk, for example. So if they feel bad in a situation, they perceive more risk. If they feel less bad, they perceive less risk. Next slide, please. Thanks to rapid funding from the National Science Foundation and my lab group at the University of Oregon, we're able to quickly start a longitudinal survey. In it, we're tracking responses to the coronavirus among a group of Americans. In the graph on the left side of this slide are the percent of our respondents who reported feeling very fearful or extremely fearful about getting the coronavirus in the future. We've measured it so far at two points in time. As you can see, those fear reactions increased from only 8% in mid-February to 14% at the beginning of March. Much has happened since then, including President Trump declaring a national emergency. The graph on the right-hand side are the percent of participants who reported being somewhat likely to completely certain that they themselves would get the coronavirus at some point in the future. And consistent with what we know about the link between emotions and risk perception, as fear rose on the left, so did risk perceptions on the right. We use our emotions to assess our risk. My group will continue to track these reactions in the same group of people as the situation unfolds. Next slide, please. Emotions simultaneously act in two other ways as well. Feelings are powerful motivators of behaviors. For example, to socially isolate, responsibly stockpile supplies and wash hands, but also to hoard supplies and perhaps to act in racist ways. Finally, negative emotion causes people to focus on congruent information. In this case, it would be that onslaught of negative information about the coronavirus. These emotional influences are generally helpful in life, but they can be harmful, and perhaps especially in situations of panic. Next slide, please. Poorly presented information can exacerbate, it can make worse the influence of emotion on risk perceptions and behaviors. Communicators often provide information in forms that are familiar and that are easy for them, or perhaps that serve their priorities and intentions, but perhaps they're forms that are not usable by those who need it. And this is especially important to think about when people's cognitive abilities are lower. Now, sometimes cognitive abilities are lower because someone has lower literacy or lower numeric abilities. But sometimes people's cognitive abilities are lower in situations like the one in which we find ourselves. People right now are under stress, for example, because they've been laid off, or they're under cognitive load because they're unexpectedly working from home in a novel and inadequate work environment with their kids side by side with them. On top of that, they're getting too much new information and too much change. What this means is that people may have more limited ability right now to stay focused and understand nuanced messages. And that's where you come in. Next slide, please. To communicate well, and especially in these trying circumstances, communicators have to properly identify what their communication should accomplish. You can't simply provide all the information and rely on the public to pick out what's important. You first need to figure out what's most important based on your best idea of what people know and don't know, and what they should know. Knowing this then helps you figure out the communication goal or goals sometimes of any one message, and the information therefore that should be shown. And then you need to choose strategically how to present it. And I have some suggestions today for how you might choose strategically. First of all is to reduce the cognitive effort you require from the public. And there are a variety of ways to do this. One example is don't use legalese kind of language. I've recently been asked to consult with my university for the coronavirus messages they're sending out to our campus. One early message draft started with really complicated legal language. They had reasons for that, but the approach lacked empathy for those who are getting the message, and the text was dense and it was difficult to understand. Overall, you should provide less information, only the critical information to meet your communication goal. If you can't provide less information, do something like provide a structured list at the top of communications, pointing people towards what might be most important to them below. Understand, though, that this choice will mean that people will miss some of the other information as they look at what they believe is most critical. This trades off, of course, with not giving them that kind of framework and having them give up on reading otherwise because the message was simply too long. Where possible, you also want to use easy to understand visuals rather than a wall of text. If you're providing numbers, do any math for them. Don't ask people to transform numbers from one type of number to another. The third thing is to actually provide numbers, working with experts to ensure you have the right ones. Numbers can be very informative if presented well. For example, they can be used to correct misperceptions. Your audience, for example, might be underestimating the proportion of people who experience only mild to moderate symptoms from the virus. If they were infected. If that's true, instead of saying for most people, the new coronavirus causes only mild or moderate symptoms, you can say instead for 80% of the patients, or whatever the current correct number is, the new coronavirus causes only mild or moderate symptoms. Even better is to acknowledge the uncertainty in those numbers too, so that people realize that things might change and that's okay. You can say something like, this is based on what we know right now and I'll update you if it changes. You can also use numbers to provide a more complete perspective. The media tends to provide the negative frame of stories. So in this case, the media is often providing the number of new people infected or the proportion of people who have died or who are expected to pass away. What happens though is that people tend to stop there. They stop with whatever the information is explicitly that they gave them without considering the positive frame of the information, and they become more frightened. In fact, in a recent New York Times op-ed, I discussed some of our new NSF-funded data that suggests that people who look often at statistics about the coronavirus felt worse and they perceived more risk. Instead, present the number infected and the number not infected, and then translate that into something that's easier for people to evaluate, the proportion of people who are expected to get infected and the proportion who are expected not to get infected. If you want to talk about the percent expected to perish, also talk about the percent who survive and those in the percent who experience only mild or moderate symptoms. Again, note the uncertainty in these numbers and that they may change over time as you learn more and that you'll communicate that. Next slide, please. Fourth, showing an image of hundreds of college students crowded on a beach sends a bad message about the social norm. It says that many people do this and therefore it might be safe and acceptable. Instead, show images of people standing 6 feet apart. Fifth, let them know this virus can be stopped and let them know concretely what you are doing and what they can do and why they should. People need to have confidence in their own actions and they need to have faith in you. Finally, test your messages at least minimally with those around you. Better, find out if your message actually did change risk perceptions and behaviors and if it worked better for some people than others, and then adjust your next message from there. Next slide, please. I'd just like to wrap up by saying that a science of risk communication exists and it should be used even in these trying times. In fact, it should be used particularly in these trying times. Knowing more about the psychological makeup of your audience and knowing more about evidence-based communication techniques will help you to present information strategically so that your audience understands it better and uses it more. Next slide, please. Thank you very much for your time.
And thank you, Dr. Peters. That was very helpful. I'd now like to introduce Dr. Baruch Fischhoff, who is the Howard Hines University Professor in the Institute for Politics and Strategy and the Department of Engineering and Public Policy at Carnegie Mellon University. His research focuses on judgment and decision-making, including risk perception and risk analysis. He's going to address how you as public officials fulfill your duty to inform in times of uncertainty. This goes directly to how authentic, compassionate, and honest you will be seen and experienced by the public. Dr. Fischhoff, I'm sorry.
Yeah. Thanks, Sandy, and thank you, APA, and thanks everybody for coming. I'm gonna pick up the thread from Ellen and talk about how do you get the content that needs to go in these messages. So next slide, please. So in order, the content should satisfy the decisions that people are facing. People are facing, like probably everybody on this call, some variant of these things. People are worried about how to make ends meet, how they can do their job safely, how they can take care of loved ones at home, how they can take care of loved ones remotely. It could be nursing homes, they could be incarcerated, where they're gonna find food, supplies, and medications, how they're gonna support most effectively the vulnerable people in those communities and many others. So these are problems that people need to solve. They need information that will help them to solve it. Next slide, please. What's particularly challenging about this situation is that the normal sources of information that people draw on are all imperfect. So the evidence that people see about this new problem may not be representative or recognized as such. So because we haven't done very much testing, it's easy to underestimate the amount of tests. Governor DeWine of Ohio recently said there have been, I believe, 7 cases in the state, but they estimated there were 100,000 people there. So you wouldn't be surprised if people underestimated the prevalence. That the mental models that we use to get through life will sometimes lead us astray. So I think people's mental models of how to keep their hands from their face are probably much better now, but their mental models of how they might be disease vectors leading through a cascade of events to causing somebody else's illness are probably not there yet. They deal with experts who may use jargon, vague terms, and not reveal the limits to their own knowledge. And they sometimes see public officials who may ignore their problems, misunderstand or spin the facts, contradict one another, or contradict themselves. So this is the information environment that people are facing and that we as communicators need to address. Next slide, please. So this communication environment, the cognitive part of it interfaces with the social and emotional parts that Roxy and Ellen will be talking about. So emotions can both cloud and focus your thinking. Poor communications can needlessly increase anxiety because you feel someone's not worrying about you and you feel even more helpless than you need be if you got the right information. Ignoring people's problems can undermine their trust in experts and public officials. And then conversely, people may strengthen their social ties, particularly when they feel the institutions have failed them. Next slide, please. So the science that we're all drawing on is risk communication or science communication or health communication. It's a mature scientific field. The constituent cognitive, emotional, and social processes have been studied for many years. Next slide, please. In the next few slides, I have a set of relatively accessible, not too jargony sources that you might want to look at. So the NASA, the National Academy of Science, Engineering, and Medicine had a report 30 years ago on improving risk communication. In its way, they're sanctifying the field. Next slide, please. Here's four other academy committees that I was also on that covered different aspects of this, of applying the basic science to particular problems that are relevant here. I was on there's a committee on environmental justice that's very strong on the importance of partnering with local communities. There's a recent committee on gain of function research, which has to do with dangerous pathogens get out into the wild. 3 years ago, I helped organize a workshop for the Forum on Microbial Threats on building communication capacity to counter infectious disease threats. And then the Food and Drug Administration sponsored a committee that looked at characterizing and communicating uncertainty in the assessment of benefits and risks of pharmaceutical products. So we all hope there will be treatments and vaccines for dealing with COVID-19. There will be great uncertainties with them, and we ought to be ready to communicate about those uncertainties so that people know what risks they're taking in the hopes of getting these benefits. Next slide, please. Here are three other sources. The National Academy of Sciences has had a series of workshops on the science of science communication that have associated special issues of the proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. And each of these, they cover a very wide range of disciplines, many of whom never thought of themselves as being in the communication business, to find out what they could contribute to these exercises. You can find 6 to 8 page essays on a variety of different things here. Next slide, please. The Food and Drug Administration, which has been a leader in this area, has a statutory risk communication advisory committee that both Ellen and I have had the honor to chair a few years ago. In order to make the research accessible to practitioners, it produced a guide to what we thought of as timely, inexpensive, scientifically grounded communication. You can download it without charge from the URL here, as you can download the other things that I showed previously. Next slide, please. Each chapter is less than 3,000 or fewer than 3,000 words. It summarizes the science, it provides practical implications, and then it shows how to evaluate draft communications. In fact, it frames the practical implications as best guesses at how you should communicate on a particular topic, recognizing that we specialists have better best guesses, but we can't predict without testing how something is going to work. And we say, how do you test for no resources at all? Much in the spirit of what Ellen said, ask a few people in the office from diverse backgrounds, education and so on, to tell you what they think. You'll always be surprised. Minimal resources and then resources commensurate with the stakes riding on the communication. Next slide, please. So how do we design these communications? It's a straightforward process. You first have to do an analysis of the specific decisions that people face. Actually, need to talk to the people, think about their goals, think about the options that they know about and don't know about. It requires a disciplined inside look at where people are. Then you do descriptive research, as Ellen discussed. You find out what their current risk perceptions are. What do they know already? What are the issues that they care about and don't care about? You often find that you need to go back and redo the analysis because you've missed something that was on your audience's agenda. Do interventions, see if you can do better, drawing on anything in the science, not just your favorite theory, which is a bit of a problem for scientists, but anything that you can use, see if you can help people. And then finally, evaluate, see if your efforts are good enough for the stakes riding on them, and then repeat as necessary. Next slide, please. This is a very general process. It draws on the same basic science that Roxy and Ellen will be talking about, and you'll find in those volumes, and you can apply it to a wide variety of things that have recurrent elements. So there are, if you engage this practice, economies of scope such that you get better and better because there are certain issues that recur, and you know how to start. You have a better best guess at how to do them. Next slide, please. Here are three papers that we did. We'll give you examples that are quite relevant to the current issue. There are two of them some initiative that Larry Brilliant organized having to do with H5N1 and a more recent paper that Roxy is a co-author on Ebola, which have sort of upbeat messages that if the communication is done well, that we found towards the end of Ebola that people had a pretty good understanding what it was, even though both the communications and the management were perhaps understandably messy at the beginning. Next slide, please. So what do you need to do in order to mobilize for build capacity for this kind of science? Well, you need a network with the needed substantive expertise. That is, you need people you can call on who will tell you about what it is that you most need to know. They don't have to be on staff, but at a local university or in your national network. You need ties with community leaders in order to find out what their needs are, because the more different they are than you, the more likely you are to miss the topic, so you get the right facts. You need a process for rapid message testing, and then you need a strategic commitment for risk communication, that the people who are setting the policy need to be aware how vital it is to address the public's needs and bring the public along. And then final slide. Here's one conceptualization of how you would manage how you would create a risk communication process that you basically, throughout the process, you're in constant communication with people from the community you're trying to help, so that you address their concerns, you don't blindside them with what you're doing, you don't stray from initial consultation to something that's very different than what you do. And if you look at the paper here, you can find additional references or elaboration on how to conduct this kind of a consultative, respectful process. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Fischoff. And particularly with that last diagram, I think many of us could be working our way backwards and forwards through that diagram many times in the next few weeks. I'd now like to introduce Dr. Roxanne Cohen-Silver. She's the professor of psychological science, medicine, and public health at the University of California, Irvine. Her research investigates the acute and longer term reactions to personal traumas, as well as impact of larger community disasters such as terrorist attacks, earthquakes, firestorms, school shootings, and war. She's going to address how public officials can promote coping and resilience in times of uncertainty. And this is especially related to helping the public act and believe in reality and optimism at the same time. Dr. Cohen-Silver.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shulman, and thank you very much to the American Psychological Association for hosting today's webinar. So again, I would like to speak a little bit about how we cope with uncertainty during this unprecedented pandemic and how we might ensure population resilience. Next slide. This is a very stressful time for our country, indeed our world. We've all, however, been through community traumas before. We know that in the United States, there have been many instances of mass violence. There have been many natural disasters. And our science tells us that people are quite resilient and that most people will get through these situations pretty well. But somehow COVID-19 feels very different. And in fact, I believe that it is different for a number of reasons. And what we've learned from prior events just may not generalize to this experience. And I think that it's important that we acknowledge how this may be different. One way is that this, as has already been mentioned, is an invisible threat. We don't really know who's infected. We don't know whether those who are infected will in fact transmit the disease to us. It's also a very ambiguous threat. We have no idea at this point how bad it will get. And we have a very uncertain future. Our time perspective is very shifted. We have no idea how long this will last. We have no understanding at this point whether we're at the beginning, middle, or closer to the end. And importantly, from a psychological standpoint, the requirements and expectations that we use social distancing actually conflicts with our natural desire to connect with our friends and family during stressful times. Next slide. It's extremely important that we acknowledge that uncertainty is stressful. And I think it's extremely important that we acknowledge that anxiety is appropriate in this circumstance. I think just acknowledging people that how they're feeling is appropriate under the circumstances can go a long way in ensuring that people don't feel like they're somehow going crazy. I think it's important that people hear the truth. Leaders tell the truth and convey that the situation may get worse before it gets better. We are probably not yet in the eye of the storm, and I think it's important that we acknowledge that in the communications that we deliver. But we don't have to be pessimistic. We can say, if we work together, if our community joins together, we can save lives. Minimizing that the uncertainty is disingenuous, but we do know that if we work together, we can save it. I'd like to spend a couple of minutes talking about the media, a topic that my colleagues and I have been studying for about 20 years since the 9/11 terrorist attacks, but over the last several decades in which we have seen quite a number of large-scale disasters in our country. And the media landscape has changed very much over the last several decades. But it is the case that people seek trusted information via the media. The media is the source from which most people glean information that Dr. Peters and Dr. Fischer have talked about, communicated. But the media is also a source of rumor and misinformation. And in fact, rumor and misinformation can appear on social media in particular, because social media doesn't have anybody like an editor vetting it for accuracy. So individuals can post and distribute information. My friend told me that they know somebody who knows something. And all of that can be spread in milliseconds. And it's extremely important that the media serve as a source of correcting inaccurate information. We have also learned from a number of studies that overexposure to media can amplify stress that can have downstream mental and physical health effects. And so it's important that government leaders see the media as allies, not adversaries, and enlist the media in correcting misinformation and reducing the distress that this misinformation and rumors can cause. Next slide. Next slide. I'd like to speak a little bit about factors that, factors that can impede community resilience. One that's been alluded to already are the times in which political agendas are driving messaging and that political agendas are conflicting or delivering contradictory messages. This is a recipe for ensuring that the community will not be resilient. It's also very important that community conflict is not fostered and in fact minimized. As we get through this crisis, it's important that we continue to say that we are all in this together rather than seeing one's adversaries as somebody that one should distrust. And it is extremely important that we do not have insincerity from our leaders. This also is a recipe for impeding community resilience. Next slide. But there are many ways that we can maximize community resilience that we've learned from the field of stress and coping over the last several decades. One thing that leaders can do is enlist community support via strong social institutions that have existed prior to this crisis. So enlisting faith-based alliances or other community organizations can go a long way to ensuring and maximizing community resilience. It's extremely important that leaders promote shared values and community solidarity. And it's extremely important that leaders bolster confidence in trustworthy authorities, such as the healthcare professionals who are fighting the disease on the front line. Next slide. Other factors that can help us maximize community resilience are recognizing that anxiety is contagious. And so it is extremely important that the communicator not let their own anxiety leak out. But it's also important to recognize that the other side of the coin is also true. Compassion is contagious. And we can use that positive inclination toward joining together to help maximize community resilience. Leaders can encourage positive community outcomes, such as altruistic behavior or social cohesion. Community leaders can suggest ways in which individuals can come together, even if virtually. It's important that we encourage people to take advantage of the technologies that are now at our fingertips, to reach out to loved ones, to friends, to encourage people to make calls to their neighbors or to individuals who are living alone. These are ways that we can maximize community resilience as we cope with this unprecedented. Thank you. Next slide.
Thank you so much, Dr. Cohen-Silver. I think it's especially important that we are conveying what we know from research about helping people know what they can do. And that really promotes resiliency when people have things they can focus positively on doing in a time of crisis. I'm now pleased to introduce my co-moderator, Dr. Arthur Evans, who's the CEO of the American Psychological Association. He's going to provide some commentary and start off our questions and answers. I'm sure our presenters have given you a lot of good things to think about, but I'm sure there's some specifics that you might have in mind that we're happy to try to address. Dr. Evans comes to his current position as a scientist, practitioner, clinical and community psychologist. And most importantly, I believe for this session, he himself was a public official for 20 years prior to coming to APA. So he has sat in your shoes and addressed many crises himself as a public official. His research is focused on evidence-based practices and behavioral health service delivery. So Arthur, from your perspective as a leader, can you give us some of your thoughts as we're getting this question and answer period started?
Well, first of all, I want to thank our presenters who did a really great job, Dr. Silver, Peters, and Fischoff, for your expertise on this issue. And, you know, thinking about my own experience having been a public official, I was, I remember on 9/11, I was in the armory at the state capitol in Connecticut on the day of 9/11. And just what that is like for those of you who are public officials and you have to manage those crises, the very long days, the very long nights. And meanwhile, you have a family and you have all of the responsibilities that the people you're trying to protect have. And you're certainly trying to manage both your own personal life and this awesome responsibility of keeping the public safe and well. And so I hope that what we can really drill down on during the question and answer section here are some strategies that you can employ to really manage that balance and to be an effective communicator and an effective leader. So I want to start off, and we have a good bit of time for questions and answers. So I want to start off with just that question. If our presenters have any thoughts about the managing strategies around managing that tension between your own personal life and the emotions that that raises for you as a communicator and as a leader, and then how you balance that with being a leader and really needing to communicate effectively to the public.
Who'd like to take that one?
You have to unmute, Dr. Peters.
Dr. Peters.
I can comment on at least one portion of that. I'm sure there'll be some other perspectives on this too. But one thing to keep in mind as a leader is that you do indeed bring your emotions into the situation because you're human too. And what we know about humans just like you is that if you're experiencing negative emotion, you're going to tend to have a tendency to think more about other negative information, and you may also be much more likely to communicate it without thinking about the other side of the coin and the need to convey some positive information, some empathy, some hope. And so to consider, just to keep that in mind as you're communicating yourself and evaluating and monitoring what it is that you're doing.
Anybody else want to take a crack at that?
Let me ask a follow-up question to Dr. Peters. In your research, are there some things that you found in terms of how people's the messenger's emotional state can influence the messages? Are there some biases that occur because of the emotional state of the messenger? We've talked about, and you've talked about, the emotional state of the person receiving the information and how that can be affected. Are there some things that you found in terms of the messenger?
So we have not looked at that explicitly in terms of really getting in there and trying to study the communicator themselves and what the effects of their emotions are. What we know is a more general phenomenon from the psychology literature. And so I'm taking that more general phenomenon and looking at this is probably how it would generalize. But the question you're asking is an empirical question, really. So what we know from the general psychology is that people in a negative emotional state will tend to focus more on the negative information as opposed to positive. And so I'm generalizing from there. But as with many other things that we're talking about in this very unprecedented situation, at least I don't know of any data very specific to your question.
Very good.
I suggest one thing that we try to do for FDA. So FDA faces what they call a emerging events. That is, you hear maybe something's wrong with the cheese, or maybe a product isn't working as well, a pharmaceutical isn't working as well as you thought. or there's a medical device that seems problematic. And it's a stressful problem for the regulators, because if you move too late, then people have been hurt and you're guilty of a cover-up, and you're in a poor position to, or you're accused of a cover-up and you're in a poor position, you have to earn back the trust in your poor position to deal with it. And if you move too soon, then you created needless problems for people, you've ended up crying wolf. So we tried to offer the Risk Communication Advisory Committee, tried to offer FDA a set of guidelines for dealing with emerging events that we hoped would give people a way, their hardworking staff, a way to structure these kinds of issues, ask the same kind of questions, come up with relatively consistent policies. And I think, not speaking as an expert, but it helps to have procedures in stressful situations.
Arthur, I might add one or other aspect from the leadership literature, which is very clearly that leaders that have inaccurate perceptions of themselves compared with others, in other words, big gaps in how they see themselves versus others, tend to have more problems with leadership effectiveness. So in a situation like this, if you really don't know yourself very well, if you don't know how you tend to behave, if you don't know how well you're managing your emotions, then you're going to have a very hard time estimating the impact that you're having on people, and you can land up in a lot of continually tough situations. So that whole issue of knowing yourself and self-knowledge becomes critical as a tool to manage the perceptions of others at that point, but it requires an accurate perception of self first.
Great. I want to remind our listeners that you have an opportunity to ask questions, so get those into us. We'll keep going until we get some questions from our listeners. Another question that I want to ask our panelists is about the current political divide in our country. And there's a growing body of research that is showing that how people understand information that they're presented with is heavily influenced by where they are on the political spectrum. So conservatives tend to interpret information differently, same information differently than people who are more liberal in their political ideation. And on this issue, at least in the popular media, you're seeing different communities understand this current crisis differently. For public officials who have to communicate to a broad spectrum of people, do you have any thoughts about how they can do that, given that people are probably hearing what they're saying very differently depending on where they are on the political spectrum?
Well, I can start first, and I hope my colleagues will jump in afterwards here. I think if you've seen some of the recent studies, there definitely are percentage differences in political perspective and a positive or negative perspective on what's going on, or accurate versus inaccurate information around data at this point. I think, Arthur, one of the things that public officials can do is, if you use the research that we've been talking about and anticipate what some of the responses are in the audience and put them out there ahead of time. Because I think, for example, if you say, for some of you out here, you might be saying to yourself the following: here's what I would say to you, and target a message that approaches that group. For some of you, you may have a different view of it this way, and it might be. So in any one of these examples, for example, some of you might be out in the audience saying, this really isn't affecting me in my small town at this point, so why should I bother? Versus some of you who are in larger communities or communities that have already been affected, you might be saying something very different, like, oh my God, when's it coming to my house? So you can use examples coming from those different perspectives so that the audience knows that you recognize that we're all in this together, but we're not all having the same perceptions and experiences about it.
Yeah. Dr. Silver, you're muted. You have to unmute.
Okay. Yes. One of the things that social psychology has told us is that people hear what they want to hear, and that makes it this a little bit more complicated. But what also makes this a little bit more complicated is the differential sort of political leanings of the different media sources. And so, because a lot of individuals get their information from the media, it is important that those who might be on the other side of the political divide understand the conflicting messages that they're getting, that those individuals are getting from their media sources. And that's why I said it's extremely important for leaders to work with the media, see them as allies rather than adversaries. And that would be to sort of reach over the aisle of the media aisle to the other side and to try to work with those media sources as well to share what we do know. And there's a lot of science that's been developed and has been rapidly communicated in the scientific journals in the last 2 months. There's a great deal that we don't know, but things are shifting by the day. And it's extremely important that there is somebody on the team who is keeping abreast of the science to ensure that that kind of information is communicated accurately.
So I would say, just echoing what Roxy said, both Roxy and Ellen have surveys in the field that are giving us the, you know, a picture of where the public is, very relevant to policies, and somehow the staff of political public officials ought to be bringing that to their attention, and rather than flying blind. We often don't have that kind of concurrent evidence, but I think largely thanks to this funding from the National Science Foundation, we're in a position where we can do better now. It's a very complicated, it's a very large, really rich research literature in a very complicated area. I think one thing that some of the studies find is that there's greater consistency, there's greater agreement on what to do than there is on what to talk about it, so that a gifted communicator will find a way not to make things practical issues that people will agree on because they have a common goal, and not force anybody to make a consent, to make it clear that they've heard the different parties, recognize the legitimacy of their overall position, but we have a problem to solve here. Can we find some way that will address everybody's concerns?
So to delve a little bit more on that, so if you're a public official, you're in a community that has a wide range of perceptions about the current crisis, you might focus more on what everyone knows is a challenge, which might be the people who are unemployed in the community and trying to solve that problem. Would that be the kind of thing that you're talking about?
Yeah, and then you, as I guess from your experience, you would want to be in the position of knowing, having those community confidants who will tell you what's going on and will vouch for you when you're approaching people who might perceive you as being on the other side of the political divide. So that's, I think, you know, that's what staff can really help you to do.
Unmute Dr. Peters. Unmute. We still don't hear you.
Thank you. Yeah, it's actually the organizer who controls us being muted. I just wanted to add here a little bit from our data. We certainly see these political divides on emotional reactions as well as risk perceptions. People who lean more liberal are more fearful and they're perceiving more risk than people who lean more conservative. Just to back up to something we talked about before, we talked about the idea of knowing your audience. And it's important as a communicator to know that these kinds of differences are going to exist, and that and so that you're not surprised about them when you go out and communicate with people. One disheartening piece that comes not from our current data, but from some past research that I've done, as well as that Dr. Fischoff has done, is that it's people who are more scientifically literate, more numerate, more educated, who tend to show the greatest political divides when there in fact are large political divisions on an issue. And so again, knowing that that may be occurring out there, you don't want to be surprised by people who you consider to be quite smart and intelligent, and of course they are, but they're maybe politically dividing even more than someone who is less educated, for example. So it's important, again, just to know your audience so that you're not surprised when you go out to communicate. And then just this is sort of going ripping off of what Dr. Fischoff said a little bit, the idea that one of the underlying reasons that seem to exist for why these political divides exist is that people are essentially wanting to remain part of their own tribe. And so they don't want to, for example, if I'm extremely conservative, I don't want to disavow conservative beliefs because then you know, I'm in conflict then with the people that I have most contact with. But that's only one goal that people can have. People can have many other goals. The goal that Baruch was talking about was one. You could think about back to a goal that Dr. Silver was talking about earlier, the idea that we're all in this together and to try to think about lifting people up to more of that goal state. And use that as a replacement tool.
Good. And I have one more question that I want to pose to you, and then we're going to go to our audience, which I think has some questions. And this is, again, talking about the audiences that public officials have to communicate to. One of the things in all of the positions that I've held, which was always a challenge, is that communities are very diverse, particularly large urban communities. And you will have a wide range of educational levels. You will have some people who speak different languages, maybe from an immigrant community. You might have people who are from different socioeconomic groups. And so how messages are received, they're going to be filtered through those various kinds of demographics. And so there was a mention of partnering with communities in terms of as a strategy for reaching people. And I was wondering if you all had some examples of that, because I imagine that many of the people on this call are in that position. As this moves forward, they're going to have to start tailoring their messages to subgroups within their communities over time. So I was wondering if you had some examples and some suggestions that you might give them around how they can approach that partnering with people at the community level.
So I'd just like to address this for a minute. I've conducted research in several different communities that have been immersed in a crisis. And one of the things that for the communities that were most resilient, some of the things that were most effective were reaching out to trusted leaders outside of the government. So that is in churches, synagogues, mosques, places of worship. That's a very important source of reaching out to a community. Those are pre-existing trustworthy authority that are not seen as politicizing the issue in general. Schools, superintendents, principals, teachers are another source. Physicians and physician groups that can communicate this information. So it's taking it out of the government realm and taking it into the communities that have direct contact with their constituents.
And this may well, you know, fit with your, you know, public, you know, service experience, but there can be problems where communities say, well, where were you before you needed us? And then often there are someplace in your social network, you may need to find somebody in your social network who will tell you the person that fits, the people who fit Roxy's description, that will then welcome you in and vouch for you and sort of explain where you were all these years. I'm married to one of those people, and it's kind of miraculous how somebody who can do that kind of miracles is somebody who can do that kind of networking, and then sometimes, you know, people can just take it from there. So
great. All right, we have some questions. Let's hear from our audience.
Sure. So we have some questions that were submitted in the question box and some that were submitted ahead of time. We'll get to as many of them as we can. The first question is sort of a three-parter. So what are your thoughts about communicating with constituents through teletown hall meetings? How is that different than social media or print? And are there any speed bumps to be aware of when communicating in a teleconference approach?
Who would like to answer that one?
I'm not sure we have.
Go ahead.
I'll defer to my colleagues. I'm not sure that we have the data yet on this. Teleconferencing is a pretty new phenomenon, and we may not yet have the data.
In terms of the nonverbal, you all, I think, alluded to that a little bit, that when you're communicating, there are certainly the words that you use, but then there are the nonverbal cues that people pick up from the communicator. And I was wondering if you just had any thoughts about how that might complicate or maybe even enhance that kind of a format.
Well, Arthur, I think one piece of this is, again, it goes back to a little bit of self-knowledge about how you do come across to others. And one of the possible advantages of posting on social media is you can post something, be it a short video or whatever, where you have some ability then to put out a message that looks like the message you want to put out. And so there is some advantage in that, that it reinforces whatever your values are, whatever the meta messages that you're trying to say above everything else. The trade-off of that is in town hall meetings where people actually either get to see you or physically hear you and will judge by tone of voice or by physical cues some of the issues that we raised today, like authenticity, honesty, compassion, directness. I think weigh in those situations which of the messages will, which of the media at this point, in the absence of having a lot of data, which of those media will more accurately portray for you or your public official, if you're a staff member, the message as intended, and which conveys that all of those things, the authenticity, the honesty, the compassion, and the directness and clarity that you need. That may make some weigh in of your decision.
Sure.
I would also add that this may interact with how well you know your audience. If you expect that you know your audience well and you have something very concrete and specific to communicate, my guess is it doesn't matter very much across those formats. But if you're not sure where your people are, if you're not sure exactly what surprises might come up, the webinar kind of format can be one that at least allows you to adjust. It does also allow you to adjust poorly, but it does allow you to adjust in case people are coming in with a different perspective than what you thought they were going to.
Great. Next question.
Okay, so one of the questions that we got in advance was, are there any modifications to your recommendations that we can or should make to better communicate to diverse groupings of communities?
So I would just give the standard advice, find some confidence in those communities who would critique your messages before you go out. Our standard is what's called a think aloud protocol, a cognitive interview, probably has other names, and just say, this is what I'm thinking of saying. Tell me everything that comes into your mind. This is a test of the message, not a test of you. And, you know, I think you're always surprised how long you've been in the business. People see things, they see words differently. The examples now of the difficulty that various leaders are having in communicating the kind of, is it a lockdown or just what is it that we're doing? The very same words mean different things to different people, and you sense that they were well-intended, but just didn't find out how people translated those words into the way people like them speak and the specific issues that they're facing.
And one of the things that happens when that information is communicated to individuals who might have heard it differently than you intended is that then within a few hours or days, you have to send out a correction. And I have received three corrections this week within 24 hours after a communication was delivered. And I think that, you know, the subject line actually says correction. And so I think it's very important what Dr. Fischoff is saying about testing the communication before it goes out.
I would also add that the kind of evidence-based communication techniques that I mentioned earlier and that others have also mentioned to some extent matter more if you're working with audiences that are less educated. I have studied this personally. I've studied this most within people who are better and worse at math. And looking at presentation of risk numbers, for example, or other kinds of numeric information. And what you can see quite clearly is that you have to be very careful with communication of numbers with people who are less numerate, who are less good at math, and doing the kinds of things, keeping in mind that less is more, that you want to prioritize information. You communicate only that very most critical information if you can, or at least order information so that the most critical information comes first. Those kind of simple ideas of less is more matter more with diverse audiences.
Next question.
The next question we have is, what is the best way to shift constituency from seeking blame to seeking a positive path forward?
Who'd like to take that on? Isn't that more of a question of resilience? Trying to move from worry to resilience in some ways, fear to resilience. Roxanne, can you help?
I'm trying to think about a science-based response to that question, and I'm having a little bit of trouble. Yeah. I think it's important to focus on the activities that one can do, but I'm going to bounce this to my fellow panelists and see if they have any thoughts as well.
I guess I would add, and there is not a lot of I'm not aware of a lot of science around this, but I would add that with using transparent communications, telling people what you know and what you don't know, that you can help to at least get them to better understand and hopefully accept the uncertainty that's involved. And that itself should hopefully reduce people's fear and get them closer to a point of acceptance, but acceptance of uncertainty in their lives, but also acceptance of the idea that you will come back and you will continue to be transparent with communication. So that they don't have to worry about things might change and I won't know.
Great. Next question.
This next question is also sort of a multi-part, so bear with me. Are there specific best practices for assembling resource pages or lists for busy local officials? More specifically, how should we balance putting the maximum quantity of applicable resources in front of people with the limitations on how much people can realistically parse, especially as the resources expand and change as the situation evolves?
This is a common problem or challenge for people who work in government, particularly people who are staffing executives. How much do you give them And are there some science-based ways that you can present that information in a way that you're able to digest it much more effectively? Whether it's a written document or even a briefing that you're giving someone, do you have any advice to folks who are in that position of having to communicate to people who, again, are not only busy, but may be in a crisis on cognitive overload themselves?
Yeah, I think also from working with leaders and applying the scientific principles of focusing on a critical few and being clear that when you give resources out, it's probably better to give a fewer resources and give a one-line summary of why that resource might be especially important so that people can figure out how it relates to your message. Here's a resource that really works on this particular issue. If you want to know more about this particular thing we're talking about, here's the resource, as opposed to just here's a bunch of resources on the coronavirus. That doesn't necessarily help people make critical choices at a time when you want them to focus on significant few things. So it's probably better to have multiple messages go out with one or two resources per message than a one message with, you know, all the resources you can possibly think of for that, and helping people guide people through that in a clear way.
I would also add to that a couple of things just based on my own experience. I think keeping information to one page, if at all possible, is really important. There's a psychology for a busy administrator. If you give them two pages versus one page, the way they receive that is going to be very different. It puts more onus on you, the staff person who's trying to prepare, because you're going to have to make some decisions about what's important and what's not. The other strategy is to do the one pager and then have the backup information behind it, so that you can say, here's an important resource. If you want to know more information, there's backup information that's behind it. And I think that that's been an effective way for people who are really busy to get what they need, but then to be able to drill down and get the detail that they might want based on something that they might be interested in.
Yeah, and Dr. Peters, you mentioned the notion of cognitive overload. And I think that there's probably a lot of relevant science to what happens even to high functioning people, public officials who are high functioning at a time like this, when all this information is coming in from multiple sources. Can you say a little more about what happens in cognitive overload?
Everybody is on cognitive overload these days. You know, even having for us, having the oddness of doing a webinar sort of last minute is cognitive overload for us, as I'm sure it is all of you listening in on the webinar. One of the things that comes out very clearly in the research on topics like this is that idea of, again, providing less information. And so Dr. Shulman who suggested having just very few resources available in a list. And in that case, maybe you can do that if you know exactly who to target. That's not always possible. Sometimes you don't have the time to figure out how to target people. You don't have the time to cut down the list and send it out at the exact right times for when people are going to need it. But there are other things that you can do. You can actually organize those kinds of lists. It does take some resources from you, of course, but you can organize those kinds of lists in ways that people will understand them better and be able to effectively navigate their way through the list better, or not do it as well. So for example, those kinds of lists are often just listed alphabetically because, well, I want to provide everything and I'll do it alphabetically because, well, maybe someone will know a name and they can find it easily then if it's alphabetical. The problem is that it's not organized topically at that point. And so if instead you have particular buckets of resources that you know are critical to people, but some people are going to want this something from this bucket, other people are going to want something from this other bucket. If you organize very carefully by those buckets, and maybe even have another ordering within each bucket, maybe by cost, if that happens to be an element that's important, or maybe there's some other element that's important within each of the individual buckets. If you can do that kind of organization can go a long way to allowing you to have a longer list, although probably keep it to one page, as Dr. Evans was saying, but to have a longer list that people can quickly find their way through.
Something that I've heard, I've never seen evidence on its efficacy, but it makes sense on first principles, is to have a standard structure for the briefings. And so forward-facing briefings that say, this is what I promised to do last time when I was here, this is what I've been able to do, and this is what I'm planning to do next time. But I want to hear your input on how satisfactory it's been and what you would really want. Because under the first principle would be that under cognitive load, people like to have a common script, and the official who's trying to deal with this, it's altogether possible to forget something from the previous time for an audience that's actually waiting to see that, to see whether or not that's been delivered. It may actually have been delivered, checked off mentally, and the official has moved on to something else. So makes sense that it should work, although I've never seen evidence on it.
And one other thing I would add is the importance of understanding the recipient. Some people are very visual and like graphics and pictures. Others like more verbal. And I think one of the questions to always ask yourself is, how does this person like to receive information? And then tend towards those kinds of strategies as opposed to what you might feel more comfortable with. But what is the receiver's preference, and try to use those kind of strategies. Next question.
Okay, this may be, we may not have time for any more than this, but I think this is a good question potentially to end on. It is, how do I cope with my own stress and uncertainty and still project calm and control?
So one of the things that I think is most important is to recognize that, as I said earlier, these kinds of emotions are appropriate under the circumstance. And I think that people can make themselves feel worse if they think somehow that they're behaving abnormally or that they're going crazy. So I think it's very important that we understand that this is an extremely stressful time for everybody. Everybody has their own crisis, many crises that they're going through. It may be economic, it may be worrying about their children, it may be worrying about their elders. All of these, the future of their industry, all of these things play into the anxiety, which I think is really quite appropriate. And I think what's most important is to not sensationalize that anxiety, to try to remain as calm as one can be. I think back to Rudy Giuliani in the days after 9/11, just who exuded calm, authoritative information, but also was real. He was showing his own pain. And I think it's appropriate to do that. I think that to minimize this and to minimize the seriousness of this just makes you seem disingenuous. And that is not the way to enlist people into joining what your recommendations, which in fact are going to be quite difficult. Staying at home, not reaching out, not getting together. I was reading something this morning from a colleague who shared with me that she has a teenage daughter who is sneaking out of the house to try to connect with her boyfriend. I mean, these are things that these are real challenges that people have. And I think that we just have to acknowledge that we're in an uncertain time, and that this will be difficult, maybe more difficult before it's going to be better. But again, we're all in this together. And I think that being authentic and compassionate and empathic, as opposed to being filled with legalese, I think is far more likely to connect with one's audience. And I strongly suspect that Dr. Bishop and Dr. Peters would agree with me.
Yeah, I think perhaps something else that might work on, I would think would work on first principles, is to have a division of labor between being the emotional, spiritual leader and having this, and having some other people do the staff work. So you don't have to memorize, master everything, which you're never going to do because you don't have the expertise of your staff. And that gives you something consistent with your role and avoids the extra cognitive load of something that's likely to backfire on you if you pretend to have technical expertise that you don't, and will arguably empower your staff in a situation where they're also under stress, that their expertise is recognized and they're given an opportunity to shine.
I might also add to this question, as I think first thing is that you have to acknowledge that you're probably anxious like everybody else. We're all, that part is a common experience that everybody has. And I think you also have to ask yourself, what's worked when you've been under pressure in the past? Some of us have already practiced coping and resilience skills that are helpful, and some of us haven't. So I think what has worked for you, and we do it in different ways. So what has worked for you? The other thing is that crisis situations will tend to bring out your worst fears. And so understanding what you're saying to yourself, if you can literally understand what the thoughts are that are going through your head, you might find some familiar patterns there that you need to talk yourself literally out of and begin to replace them with some things about what you can do in the situation. And then, of course, I think the other piece for public officials in particular is always the challenge of having people around you that you trust, so that when you talk out loud and share how you're reacting, it doesn't come back in a way that was unintended by the public. And so having that support team around you where you can freely discuss how you're feeling and how you're reacting on a daily basis, because it will come out somewhere else if you don't have a safe and a secure and a constructive place to put it, I think is really important in recognizing where that is. And that can vary for every public official, but you need that. And the staff needs that as well. So trying to figure out how to put those in your daily routines is really important.
So before I turn it back over to Dr. Shulman, I just want to thank our audience in particular. Public servants do a tremendous job for the public, and we know that you're making a lot of sacrifices, whether you're in the legislature or you're in an executive branch position. We know that there are long hours. We hope that what we've been able to provide you today, information that's based on good psychological science to help you do your job. We hope that that's been helpful. One thing that I will add is that it really is important for you to take care of yourself and to not feel guilty about that. And I know what it's like when you're trying to manage as much as you're trying to manage now, but you got to put your mask on first, as they say on the plane, if you want to help other folks. And so we want to encourage you to do what you need to do to take care of yourself, take care of your family, so that you can be excellent in the work that you do for the public. So Dr. Shulman?
Yes, I want to thank everybody for coming, and I want to remind you, and this is probably the most important message, the American Psychological Association, psychology and psychologists are here to help you as public officials, to help you deal with those personal challenges that you might be facing and the issues that your constituents are facing. Part of the reference material today has our contact information in it, and we would encourage you to contact us. We literally represent 121,000 people internationally and nationally who are experts in human behavior in virtually every walk of life that's touched by this crisis. So please feel free to call upon us to partner with you, to help you with the very serious challenges that you're facing. We wish you every success, and we're rooting for you, and we'd like to be a part of the solution with you. So thank you very much. Please contact us if we can help you in the future. Take care, everybody.
And thank our panelists for a great job. Thank you
so much. I'd like to thank especially our panelists, Dr. Silver, Dr. Peters, and Dr. Frischoff for their information today. And I'm sure they will be available and can help you with further information as well. So thank you, everybody, and take care.
Thank you.
Thank you.